We've got a water tank out the back, and checking the level has always been a bit of a hassle. I'd have to climb up an old, rusty ladder, lift the sheet of tin covering it, and try to peek inside. But half the time it was too dark to see anything properly anyway. So I wanted a smarter, easier way to monitor it, something I could just check from my phone. That led me to build this. A solar-powered, Wi-Fi-connected water level sensor using an ESP32C3 and an ultrasonic distance sensor. It's completely standalone, runs on a rechargeable battery, and integrates with Home Assistant using ESPHome. The basic idea is simple. I'm using an ultrasonic sensor to measure the distance from the top of the tank down to the water surface. That data gets sent to Home Assistant, and I can view it on a dashboard whenever I want. It's low power, runs off a small solar panel, and everything is housed in a 3D printed enclosure. It wakes up, takes a reading, sends the data, and then goes back to sleep, or tries again if the send fails. Here's a quick breakdown of the components I used for this build. ESP32C3 Super Mini. This handles the logic, Wi-Fi connection, and sending data to Home Assistant via ESPHome. AJSR04M ultrasonic sensor. Waterproof and decent range, perfect for tank measurements. TP4056 module with protection. Charges the battery safely from solar input. 3.7 volt lithium ion battery. Powers the system when there's no sun. 5 volt boost converter. Steps up the battery voltage to power both the ESP32 and the sensor. 470 microfarad capacitor. Smooths out voltage drops when the ESP or sensor draws power. 6 volt 1 watt solar panel. Enough to keep the battery topped up with occasional sun. And finally, a 1K and 2K resistor voltage divider to bring the echo pin signal down to 3.3 volts for the ESP. All that is mounted inside a custom 3D printed enclosure I designed in FreeCAD and wired together on a perf board. It's a simple setup, but it does everything I need. Originally, I planned to use a D1 Mini. I actually went ahead and soldered everything up on a perf board. Added the TP4056 module, headers, a capacitor, wiring for the sensor, it was all looking good. But I hit a wall with deep sleep. No matter what I tried, the D1 Mini just wouldn't wake back up reliably. I had RST connected to D0 as recommended, but it still wouldn't trigger after sleeping. So I swapped it out for an ESP32C3 Super Mini, and that solved the problem straight away. The C3 supports deep sleep really well, plus it's more efficient and compact. It's been rock solid since switching. Powering the whole setup is a 6 volt 1 watt solar panel, which feeds the TP4056 charge controller with protection. That's charging a 3.7 volt lithium ion battery, which then runs into a 5 volt boost converter. The boost converter powers both the ESP32 and the ultrasonic sensor. Right after the converter, I added a 470 microfarad capacitor. That just helps smooth out voltage drops, especially when the ESP boots up or the sensor starts pulsing. These little regulators can be a bit spiky under load, so the capacitor gives some stability. There's no battery monitoring built in just yet, but I'll definitely be adding that in a future version so I can track charge levels over time. To keep everything low power, I'm using ESPHome's deep sleep feature. When the device boots up, it tries to connect to Wi-Fi and then to the ESPHome API. If both of those succeed, it takes a reading, sends the data, and then goes into deep sleep for 60 minutes. But if it fails, for example, if it can't connect to Wi-Fi or Home Assistant is offline, it goes into a shorter 5-minute sleep and keeps retrying until it's successful. That way, it doesn't burn through battery sitting there awake doing nothing. The sensor is an AJSR04M. It's waterproof and pretty reliable for outdoor use. It needs 5 volts to run properly, so I'm powering it directly from the boost converter. Trigger is wired to GPIO4 and echo is connected to GPIO3 on the ESP32. Since the echo pin outputs 5 volts, I added a voltage divider to bring that down to safe levels. I used the 1K and 2 2K resistors, which brings the voltage down to around 3.3 volts, perfect for the ESP's input. Once the wiring was sorted, I designed a custom enclosure in FreeCAD to house everything. I measured the components to make sure they'd fit snugly, and left space for the solar panel on top and the sensor mounting at the front. I printed the box in PLA, mostly because that's what I had on hand. I know it's not ideal for outdoor use, since it can absorb moisture and go brittle in high temps, especially under the Aussie sun. So this version's more of a prototype. I'll probably reprint it in PETG or ASA later on. I also heat set some brass inserts into the case so I could screw the lid on securely. The solar panel is mounted to the top, with the wires running through the side of the enclosure. I sealed around the panel and cable entry points with silicon to help prevent water getting in. It's not waterproof, but it should hold up okay while I test it. At the moment, the box is just sitting loosely on top of the tank. I haven't mounted it properly yet. I want to see how it performs over the next few weeks first. It's been sending data without issue. ESPHome pushes the values into Home Assistant, and I've got a gauge and a history graph set up on my dashboard. The battery voltage seems to be holding up well, and the solar panel is keeping things topped up, even during cloudy days. So yeah, this is where the project is at right now. It's a working prototype, and honestly I'm pretty happy with how it turned out. Eventually I'll mount it properly, make a more weatherproof enclosure, and add battery monitoring into the mix. I'm also planning to use it for automations, like sending notifications when the tank gets too low, or tying it into irrigation schedules. But for now, it's just great to be able to check the level without climbing a rickety old ladder. If you're building something similar, or have suggestions for improvements, feel free to drop them in the comments. I'll leave the part list and YAML config down in the description if you want to give it a go yourself.